Well, hello, Carmel Mountain Christian Church. Welcome. Good morning. We are so glad you're here. We hope you're ready to worship because he is worthy to be praised. To live a perfect life. He came to be the living word, our light. Came to die so we'd be reconciled. He came to rise to show his power and might. That's why we praise him. That's why we sing. That's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this king. It's because he gave his everything. Because he gave his everything. Oh, oh. He came to live. He came to live. Came to be our conquering, came to heal, and show the lost ones in love. He came to go, prepare a place for us. That's why we praise him. That's how we sing him. That's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down. He gave his everything. Cause he gave his everything. Yeah. Oh. Hallelujah. Cause he gave his everything. Cause he, that's why we praise him. That's why we praise him. That's why we sing. That's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this king. Cause he gave his everything. Cause he gave his everything. Cause he gave his everything. Yeah. Oh, ooh, yeah.
I don't know about you, but I love the wisdom that I find in the book of Proverbs. Today, let's talk about Proverbs 11:25. It says, "A generous person will prosper, and whoever refreshes others will be refreshed." What does that mean? It sounds good, but let's dig in and unpack it a little bit. What does it mean, a generous person? Well, for one, it's not an adjective. It is a noun. It's not saying how we are, but who we are. So in our identity at the deepest points, this verse is talking about the fact that we can be generous people. It means that we are people who bless, who are a gift, who are a treaty of peace to the world. I don't know about you, but in a year that started with almost going to war with Iran and then having a global pandemic and the racial unrest, centuries of it has come to the fore again for us here in the United States. Being peace treaties to the world sounds like a really good addition to what's going on around us. And this verse continues. It says, a generous person will prosper, not might prosper, but will. And what does that word prosper mean? It is getting to the idea of you will be made fat. Okay, after quarantine, nobody needs to be more fat, but this is not talking about that kind of fat. It is talking about the weight of God's glory. It is talking about his holiness. How do we know? Because that term carries in it this idea of being anointed. Anointed with the holiness of God, the weight of his presence in our lives gives us something to hold on to when everything seems so chaotic. In the second part of the verse, we see an additional promise. Whoever refreshes others will themselves be refreshed. And that word refreshed, when you think of it, close your eyes and think about it for a minute. Who doesn't need that sense of a drenching mist, a waterfall, a summer rain? Anyone feeling parched these days with the news and the chaos and the intensity and the strain, financially, emotionally, socially, mentally? We need to be refreshed. And it promises in this verse that when we refresh others, when we are that peace bringing and that goodness and that anointing bringing presence in the world, we will be refreshed. God wants us to be full and whole and full of his holiness in this season. He doesn't want us scraping around feeling like we are in a spiritual and emotional poverty. A generous person will prosper, and whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. We believe these scriptures here at Carmel Mountain Christian Church. We believe that God's promises will come to pass. If you believe this too, will you be in your soul that generous person? Will you give of your finances, of your time, of your resources, of your prayer? God promises he'll make you fat in good ways when you do this. The anointing holiness of God. Will you give in faith, believing that when you do, when you bring that refreshing, God will not fail to refresh you too. Will you pray with me? Oh, Lord, we've gone through so many months of just ups and downs. It can be exhausting. It can dry us out. We feel like beef jerky after a while with all of the intensity, all of the strain, the hard news, the bad news. But God, you give us good news. You give us the news that when we refresh, you will refresh us back. When we are in our character, who we are is generous, that you will fill us. You will give us the weight of your holiness like a soft weighted blanket when we're feeling scattered or anxious. You are the holiness in our lives. We want to partake of that. We want to be the reflection of your generosity. We want to be part of your peace treaty to this world. Give us the courage. Give us the courage to be those generous people, Lord. Bless the financial resources people share today. Bless them, refresh them, drench their lives with your goodness. In the name of Jesus, amen.
these bones will sing. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Hallelujah. Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb, for you are holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. Amen. For you are holy, holy. are worthy. Worthy is the Lamb. You are worthy. Worthy is the Lamb. For you are holy. Holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Yeah. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy. Worthy is the Lamb. Amen. You are worthy. You are worthy.
Summer Madness, everybody. Coolin' the Gang. Our summer series called Summer Madness, that's our theme jam. I hope you like it. I don't know, maybe some of you even went out and bought it. I don't know. Summer Madness. Let me get to it today. First of all, I'm really, really excited about what we're getting ready to do with our BYO Summer, Bring Your Own Summer. So we already know that you heard from Lori that the women are getting ready to do something. We have our prayer getting ready to do something. We want you to be comfortable during this COVID-19 time and know that we're doing our best to protect you, but we also want to have a little bit of fellowship with you. So we're super excited about that. The Summer BYO. If you feel comfortable, make sure that you join us. And be on the lookout because we have something really special planned for you in the BYO Summer coming up in August. So be ready. Now let's do something else too. So you're on Facebook, you're on Twitter, you're on YouTube. How about you all push the share button? How about you like us? You push the share button and share this message that we're about to do with someone else. And of course, we've been asking you for a while to subscribe. So push the subscribe button, share our website with other people because people need to hear about the Word of God. Amen. I'm going to sit down and have a little bit of a talk with you this morning before I get into my message for today, which is called Defender. But before I do that, I want to just really have a little bit of a chat with you and talk about what's happening in our world a little bit today with COVID-19, the coronavirus, and all that, and the impact that it's having probably on you and on people you know. Because, listen, we in the Christian community have pretty much been shut down as far as gathering together. So a lot of what is happening right now is not allowing us to really get together the way that we're used to it and the way that tradition has always done it. So we all have to ask ourselves the question, what are we doing now to stay close to Christ, to stay close to each other, and not forsake the fellowship of the saints? Did you know that's on every individual person? A lot of the strength that you have and the strength that you're going to get in the Lord, you're going to have to use your own resources to get it. What do I mean by that? I mean, if you don't have routines in place that keeps you, I'm not talking about necessarily you and your spouse and you and your children, and all of that is important, but I'm talking about you and your temple. We must, during this time, have the type of relationship with Christ where we can make it and maintain who we are, sort of external of all the other things that are going on around us. So today, in the message that I have for you called Defender, I want to give you some tools to help you navigate through this COVID time that we're having. Don't you know, and haven't you noticed, that people are really, really hurting nowadays? There's a lot of people who are asking questions who were not asking questions before, and they're talking to you, and you're having to give an account for yourself, and you're having to give an account for Jesus Christ, and you maybe even are going to get challenged, or maybe you already have been challenged on what you believe. So today I want to give you some tools and equip you today with some things that you can say to people when they're challenging you, or just you want to talk about the Bible and you want to talk about what it's done for you. Then we want you to be better equipped to do that. So I have a series of questions that I want to ask you today. And I would like for you to answer the questions. Wherever you are, if you're sitting there by yourself or you're sitting there with family members, whatever, I would like for you to answer the questions. So let me say this about that. First of all, the questions are not trick questions. I'm not trying to trick you. It reminds me when I was in the classroom and I was teaching, I would tell the kids, I say, listen, I've already gone over this chapter. I've already gone over this section. I've taken the test or the quiz that I'm going to give you at the end of this teaching and this learning. And what I did was I pulled out all the questions that are on the test, and I found them in our reading. So as we're reading, I'm going to tell you what the answers are on the test. Oh, no, Mr. Hudson, you're not going to do that, are you? Sure I am. Well, why would you do that? Because I don't want to play games with you as far as education is concerned. I want you to know and be ready to be tested on the things that I want you to know or this book wants you to know. And the only way you can do that is for me to tell you what I'm going to test you on. Oh, wow, that sounds like a great deal. Let's go for it. So as I was teaching the lessons, I would say, and this right here looks like something that's going to be on the test. This right here sounds like something that's going to be on the test. And boy, they would be writing and noting and whatever. So you would think with that methodology, all of them would get an A. Wrong. Some of them got A's. Some of them got B's, C's, D's, and F's, just like you would think in any other test, even though I told them what was going to be on it. We're in a test too, or in a test also. And the test is for our eternity, and where are we going eternal? Will you pass the test? Because God has already given us the answers to the test, and they're right here. But can you stand the test? Will you be able to stand up and show yourself approved? Because he's given us the answers. So let's take a look at what we're doing today. And my first question that I'd like for you to answer is, how do you know that the Bible is true? How do you know that the Bible is true? You see, we're not living in a time where we can have anti-Christian and intellectualism. You can't be the Christian who is relying on what your mother said, what your daddy said, what you learned in Bible study, what you learned in Bible school, what you hear me standing up here and saying. Oh, no, That is not going to cut it in the current crisis that we're in, and I would even go so far to say as to where we are going in the future. Each Christian must know Christ for himself or herself, and we must learn what it says here in the Bible and be able to, because here's where the power is, here's where the authority is in here. So when we speak God's word, we can speak it with authority. So the question still remains, how do you know that the Bible is true? Did you know that most kids who are raised in the church and they take off and leave home, which they're happy to do after they graduate from high school, they go to colleges, and by the second year in college, they've given up their Christianity and everything they've learned? And that's because they maybe were equipped, but whatever they were taught by their mom and the way that they were raised would not carry them through some of the intellectual and things that they learn and what they're introduced to and their peer pressure and stuff in college. That's kind of the situation that we're in right now, even though we're not running off and leaving home and going to college. The analogy is good. That we as Christians, this world and what's going on right now would chew us up and spit us out if we don't know what this word of God says for ourselves. Somebody out there say amen. So that just means you have to spend more time with God. Here's a question I have for you, and you can write it down today. I'm going to be more academic. I got my coat on, my tie on. I'm ready to go. I'm going to be academic, which means you need to be taking some notes, because as you encounter people out there in the world and they're talking to you, you have to give an account that makes sense and is not all touchy-feely. Nothing wrong with touchy-feely, nothing wrong with testimonies, but you're going to have to come with some meat. Number one, and please answer this, yes or no, is it accurate to say that God wrote the Bible? Is that accurate? Is that easy? Is that correct? And is that the correct thing to say? Is it accurate to say that God wrote the Bible, yes or no? I'll give you a second if you need it to ponder. And the resounding answer to that question is 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16. 2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture is God-breathed, and it is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. All scripture. So the answer to that question is, it is accurate to say that God wrote the Bible. So the answer to that is yes. Did you know that in the Bible, God is quoted at least 400 times? Where he's saying, thus saith the Lord, or some phraseology which says, I sent someone to tell you this. That means that God wrote the Bible and people are just writing down what it is that God said. I'm going to get into that in a minute. Let us look to Isaiah chapter 55 and verse 11. Check this out. Isaiah says, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, some say void, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. The word of God is coming right out of his mouth, right in through the prophets, right in through the people, and right in the speaking. I have to be honest with you. I cannot stand up here and bring a message. I never have been able to do that without God breathing on me, speaking to me, giving me words, say this, say that. I came up here today and I felt something last night in the message that I was supposed to say, and this morning as I was finishing up, I couldn't remember. Oh man, that was really, really good, and I couldn't remember what it was. I came up here today, I started to speak to you, God said, here it is right here, And he told me what it was that he had told me last night, and he put it together for me. He breathed on me his breath of life and talked to me. Why and how do I know that? Because Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 7 says this, "For the word of God is living and active," which I just said to you and gave you an example, "sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of the soul and of the spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart." That's God speaking to us. He is inspiring us. Matthew 4 and 4, this is Jesus doing the talking, and he's quoting Deuteronomy 4 and 4 when he says this, and he's talking to Satan, who's trying to tempt him, he says. But he answered, Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes," where? "From the mouth of God." So when the original question that I ask you, is it accurate to say that God wrote the Bible? The answer is unequivocally, absolutely, and positively, yes. Isn't that awesome? It's awesome. Number two, second question I have for you. Does God, quote unquote, God wrote the Bible mean he took a pen in his hand and started writing the Bible, and he wrote it out, and he has that Bible that I have up here and you have in your possession? Yes or no? Does that mean that God took a pen or whatever he chooses or chose to write on and wrote the Bible? Da 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 da. Thump. I'm just messing with you. And the answer, of course, is no. The Bible, God did not sit and write down the Bible. And anyone remember seeing that movie way back in the day? I think it was in the 50s or the 60s, called The Ten Commandments. It had Charlton Heston in it, and he led the children of Israel out and through the desert, parted the Red Sea. It was an awesome movie. If you haven't seen it during this COVID time, then watch it. The Ten Commandments with Charlton Heston. And you remember in that scene where God actually wrote in the Ten Commandments, and he wrote them on the tablets. Remember this, "Thou shalt have no other God before me," and that lightning came down and hit that stone and said, and that's that in there. "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God." "Thou shalt not steal." Hollywood. But mostly, you would have to say that God did not do that with these right here. No, this was printed by who knows? I don't even know. Zodirin. They printed the Bible. You have apps. You have whatever. So God didn't just sit there and do that. But what did God do? He breathed on the authors of the Bible, and he breathed on them. I'm going to read something to you from 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. And as I'm reading this, because I don't want to read it through and then come back and read it again and make this notation, so I'm telling you now that as I'm reading this and it comes up on your screen, I want you to note where the capital S is being used, which means the Holy Spirit and the Spirit of God, and the small s, which is being used, which means you or something less than, the spiritual less than the Holy Spirit. Here it is. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, that's a small s, but the Spirit of God, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might understand the things freely given us by God. And we impart this in words, not by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual truths to those who are spiritual. So the spiritual truths, and what I gave you in my soliloquy when I first started, spiritual truths coming to you are going to come through the Spirit of God to those who are spiritual. Are you one of those? That's my question. Are you one of those? 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 21. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. People are speaking, and they are speaking for God. I'm going to get into prophecy, but it's too deep for me to get into it in this lesson, but I'm going to get into it in the next couple of weeks with you, and trust me, you better tune in, have your listening ears on, have your glasses, have your notes. You need to have all of that when I get off into that. Jeremiah 20 and 19. This is awesome. This is how Jeremiah feels about God and are we being equipped? And this is how Jeremiah feels about, did the words come from God? He says, his word is in my heart like a fire. A fire shut up in my bones. I am weary of trying to hold it in. Indeed, I cannot. I am so on fire with the word of God that's live and active and sharper than a two-edged sword. He's living in me. And the fire that's in me because of what God has downloaded in me, I just cannot contain it. I'm about to burst. I'm about to be on fire. I'm about to internally combust. With the word of God, oh, I just got to tell somebody. I got to tell somebody. Ooh, that's an awesome word of God, and that is an awesome testimony. Amen? Number three, is the Bible trustworthy and reliable? That's your question. Is this Bible right here, is it trustworthy and reliable? Simple yes or no answer. This isn't like voting for four or five candidates. Yes or no? And the answer, of course, is yes, it's reliable. And I'm going to give you three reasons why, even though there are more. Number one, because of the authors who wrote it. Number two, because of manuscript evidence, which I'm going to explain what that is, and because of number three, prophecy. Number one, the authors who wrote it. Number two, manuscript evidence. And number three, prophecy. You can trust the Bible is telling you, and what it's telling you, it's true, and it is reliable. I have some bullet notes here. I'm not going to say them fast because I really want you to write them down. Number one, first of all, the Bible is not just a book. It actually is 66 books. It's 39 books in the Old Testament and 27 books in the New. Did you know that people have been criticizing, picking that Bible apart, talking about that Bible for thousands of years? But because God breathed on it and breathed on the authors, they can't pick it all out and find any errors, no matter how much they try. Critics have been at it for a while. This Bible was written over a period of 2,000 years by 40 different authors. Think about that. A document, a book you have and you have access to that was written over a 2,000-year period with 40 different authors. And all the authors have something in common. They're doing the will of God and doing the bidding of God and giving us the same message consistently about God's eternal plan. Woo-hoo! Now that is awesome. That's awesome. This Bible that we have was written on three different continents, and it was written in three different languages, Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek. Let me give you a little bit of a resume about the authors of this Bible. Some of them were shepherds. Some of them were kings, scholars, fishermen, prophets. There was a military general, a cupbearer, and priests helped write this Bible and breathed on people with this Bible. That is a resume that you're not going to find from Islam and the Quran. You're not going to find that in Buddha. You're not going to find that. You're going to find this word of truth that God breathed on and through his people, which is reliable and trustworthy. Everybody out there say reliable. I'm waiting on you. Now say trustworthy. I'm waiting on you. This book is reliable and trustworthy. Let me talk to you about manuscript evidence. Manuscript evidence is defined as writings that occurred or that were written before the invention of the printing press. Everybody get that? So it is the writings that was written on animal hides, papyrus, was written on wood, written on stone, written on walls, whatever. And then the Gutenberg press is what most people will say is where we're able to mass produce things to bring that Bible that you have, which happened in 1444, somewhere around in there. So manuscript evidence then is the writings before the invention of the printing press. I remember I had a trip 10 years ago. My brother and I, we were in Cairo, Egypt. And when we were there, we did what all tourists do. You know, we rode and sailed up and down the Nile. And of course, why would you even go to Egypt and go to Cairo and not go to the pyramids of Giza, right? So we did that. We went and we found a guide and we paid him and we got on camels. I have some video of him and I riding across the Sahara Desert on our way to the pyramids and just riding camels. It was awesome. So we rode up and we went and we were looking at the pyramids and we're looking at the Sphinx with his nose blown off and all of this stuff. And our guide comes up to us and he says, hey, you guys want to see something special? And we're like, yeah, what is it? And he says, well, that guard over there is guarding a tomb of one of the priests from about 4,000 or 5,000 years ago. What? Yeah. And he said, he'll let you guys go down there and see that priest's tomb. And of course, there was a price for it that we had to pay, right? I don't remember, it was 20 US bucks or whatever. So we gave it to our guide. He gave it to the guard. He takes the padlock off of the entrance. And the entrance, some of you will know this, it was like the old cellars from back in the day, the storm cellars, you know, that were sort of raised above the ground just a little bit and had a couple of doors over. And he took the padlock off the door and he opened it up. And when he opened it up, that smell, that old ancient smell in a cave came out of there. So we started descending down into these catacombs and down into this cave. Listen, I was feeling like Indiana Jones, y'all, because it was dark down in there, even though they flipped on some lights. But, you know, I was looking, where's my whip? And, you know, where's that gun Indiana had and that hat? Because I'm like, I'm on Raiders of the Lost Ark adventure. And as I'm going down the stairs, we both are going down the stairs. My brother and I, the guard didn't go down there. And we're going down. On the side of the wall as we were descending was hieroglyphics. And I mean, whatever you're picturing in your head of pharaohs and queens and all of that was written down the side of the wall and all over the wall as we were descending down to this priest's catacombs. And we got to a landing and we had to turn and then we went down in again. I went, man, this is down in here a ways. And we went down in there and we saw this tomb that was still there of some ancient priest from back in the day. The point I'm making, of course, obviously, is about the writing. Because the writing that's on that wall and on the wall, we don't know what that means. You know why? Because it's so old and there's nobody really to translate a lot of that. Even the archaeologists, in many ways, can't translate all that. So the invention of the printing press, we don't have to look at hieroglyphics. We have hard copy evidence of what was written. I want to show you something that will blow your mind, because I do want to talk about manuscript evidence, because you should be able to speak intelligently and toss this at someone who is challenging you as to the validity and the trustworthiness and the reliability of the Bible. Manuscript evidence. Let's go ahead and look at this chart, which will explain that to you. On this chart, on the left, as you can see, it's telling you who the authors were. There is not anyone that I know historically who questions whether Plato lived and did some writing. But look at this. Plato and his writings were 427 to 347 BC. The earliest copy of whatever he wrote at that time period didn't come till 900 years or so later. And we can see here that there was a a 1,200 years between the time that he wrote it and a copy of it was made. And when they found it, it was only 7 copies. And so the accuracy or the reliability that Plato wrote, whatever you think Plato wrote, is zero because of the time period, the 1,200 years mainly, between the time that he wrote it and finding a copy of whatever it he wrote. Now, I'm not going to read each one of these one by one. I'm just sort of explaining to you the way that the chart works. No one questions about Aristotle. You see when he lived, B.C. You see the earliest copies. You know, can see there's 1,400 years between the original and the copy, and then there's only 49 copies of it, and the reliability of that, what we read and what you know, is that really what Aristotle said, is zero. You all get it? The Iliad. These are in your history books. These are being taught in colleges and taught in high school and higher grade level, and look at the grade levels and look at the reliability of what is being said. Now let's go down to the very end now. And there we can see that the New Testament was written in the very first century AD after the death of Christ. And there was less than 100 years between the time from the writers and the original copies to what we have. And look at that. We have 5,600 or so copies of the New Testament. And the reliability that what we have and what you have in your hand right here is 99.5. Somebody better say amen. 99.5 reliable. Why? Because we have the word of witnesses who witnessed what Jesus did, who witnessed what Jesus was, or they know somebody who witnessed it and said, this is what I saw Jesus did. The Bible is 100% reliable. What we can easily say and conclude is there is more manuscript evidence to prove that the Bible is valid than all ancient documents combined, and it's not even close. So there's your apologetics, if you want it, when someone starts up with you about the reliability of the Bible. Is it reliable? Well, is Homer, is the Iliad, is Aristotle, is all that reliable? And the answer to that, of course, is no, but the Bible is. Number 3 is prophecy. And as I said to you a minute ago, prophecy is such a big deal, and there's so much prophecy in the Bible. Actually, there's about 2,500 prophecies in the Bible. And of the 2,500 prophecies in the Bible, there's only 500 that are left to be fulfilled. So when people are starting to talk about end times, which I don't want to talk about right now, I just want to talk about the prophecies. It's just a big subject, and it's a very, very deep subject. So I'm going to have to take some time with you to do that, which I'm going to start next week. I'm going to pick this up, and I'm going to start right next week with prophecy. I will say this, Amos chapter 3, verse 7. The Lord and king never does anything without telling his servants, the prophets, about it. He doesn't do anything. So those 2,500 prophecies that I'm going to talk some about, I'm obviously not going to stand up here next week and give you 22,000 prophecies or 2,500 prophecies. I'm going to pull some out, show you some that have already happened, and maybe talk in about what's coming in the future. We'll see what God gives me. But this is where I want to leave you today. In 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 16 through 21. It's a lot of scripture, but I want you to stay with me today because I'm going somewhere with you on that. 2 Peter 1, 16 through 21. For we did not follow cunning devised fables when we made known to you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were witnesses of his majesty. For he received from God the Father honor and glory, which such a voice came to him from the excellence glory. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And we heard this voice, which came from heaven, when we were with him on the holy mountain. And so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed as a light that shines in dark places, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in our heart, knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is a private interpretation. For prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Did you all write that scripture down? Because it explains everything that I have been preaching and saying to you today. It is something that we need to know, and we need to know that it isn't just people who are talking and delivered this word of God. It isn't just that. It isn't just some man who was standing before you or some woman who was standing before you on a Sunday morning or a Wednesday Bible study or a women's group or whatever it is you're doing, but it is God himself who is breathing life through his prophets, his priests, his kings, his preachers, his people. And he's talking to us, and he's live. He is alive, and he is active and living in you. I took this verse that I just read to you and put it in a synopsis form. And I'm going to recommend to you that you write it down and you commit it to your heart. And since I just wrote it, I haven't memorized it yet. I'm not promising that I will between now and next week, but I'm definitely coming with this the next few weeks, because it describes. So write it down, get your camera, your phone ready, take a picture of your screen, snapshot, or whatever you're going to do, and get this written on your heart. Here we go. The Bible is a reliable collection of historical documents that are not myths, fairy tales, mysticism, or legends. The Bible contains eyewitness accounts written during the lifetime of other eyewitnesses recording supernatural events and prophecies. The Bible has 2,500 prophecies, to which 2,000 have happened exactly as predicted or prophesied. The Bible is solid and a firm foundation for all people for all time. And if you have an occasion, you write that down, it's okay to have it on a card and somebody's talking to you and you can just read it and say it to them if you want to. And then after you've said that to them, you need to ask them a question. Do you want to know more? Do you want to know more about this Bible? And do you want to know more about Jesus? Is your next natural progression that you would say? Amen? I hope everyone has gotten something out of what I said today. And I want to take a minute and just pray over you and this word that I've given. So, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your name is great, and you, sir, God, are greatly to be praised. Your words are true. Your words are yes. Your words are amen. and you will bring to pass everything that you have said in this great book that you gave us. So I ask, Lord, by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you would touch each and every person under the sound of my voice. And you would touch them, God. There should be a fire that's inside of them. And I speak that fire right now that's in each and every person, that you would come, God, in such a way that they just are so much on fire that they just, like Jeremiah, cannot hold it up in their bones and keep it inside. Lord, we need you now like we never have. We're in times and situations that not one person on this planet, no person in America has ever seen or anything like this before. And we live in this time, God. But we know that you, Lord, can show yourself strong in each and every one of our situations. So I speak life. I speak power. I speak the Holy Spirit over everyone. I pray, Lord, that you would just come right into our situations. Come right into our finances, God. Come in with healing, Heavenly Father, for those that need to be healed. And God, I just feel right now somebody out there is lonely. And Lord, I pray for them right now that they don't do what they're thinking about doing. But God, that you touch them right now. You know that your spirit, they know that your spirit is on them right now. And you love them. I pray, Lord, that someone knows somebody who's lonely and they'll send them this message as encouragement, that we'll do the work of the gospel of Jesus Christ today, right here, right now. We do it by encouraging our brothers and sisters and our family. They're ready. The harvest is ripe and it's ready for the picking. Send your people, Lord. And I pray that everyone who is listening to me today will say, here am I, Lord, send me. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Listen, everybody. This is a word that's going out to you. Take that word that I've given. Make sure that I said it before I started. Share. Send this to somebody. Someone says something to you this week and they're talking about they're lonely and whatever it is and they don't know what they're doing and they're confused. Whatever the case may be, send this to them. You know how. Send it to them. Listen to this again yourself. Be encouraged this week. God loves you. We love you here at Carmel Mountain Christian Church. We're praying for you. Have a great week and be safe. Amen.
Are you Lord God Almighty? Yeah. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy, worthy is the Lamb, for you are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Yeah. Worthy is the Lamb, you are worthy. Worthy is the Lamb, you are worthy, worthy is the Lamb, for you are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Yeah. Worthy is the Lamb, you are worthy, worthy is the Lamb, you are worthy, worthy is the Lamb, you are worthy. Worthy is the Lamb, for you are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Yeah. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy. Worthy is a lamb, worthy. Worthy is a lamb. Amen. You are worthy.